What's going on, everybody? Welcome to Season 2, Episode 15 of 10th Inning Screwballs. I'm Dante Esposito.
And I'm Sevy Esposito. Dante, 15. All sports, give me a 15.
Give you the best player in football, Patrick Mahomes.
Best player in football. We may discuss that later. Well, I can't think of number 15 without thinking of Thurman Munson, the Yankee captain. Played 11 seasons in the major leagues, all with the Yankees, from 69 until his death in 79. Seven-time All-Star, career batting average around 300, gold glove in consecutive years, World Series appearances for three straight years, winning two of them. In 1970, he bats over 300, voted American League AL Rookie of the Year. He was always considered the heart and soul of the Yankees. As a captain, he was the first to be selected as a captain by the Yankees since the passing of Lou Gehrig. In fact, when Lou Gehrig passed, the Yankees said, that's it. Lou Gehrig was our one and only captain and no more. And it wasn't until Munson that they said there was somebody worthy of it. Got a little odd statistic here about his career. He's the first player in baseball history to be named a college baseball All-American and then in the major leagues win the Rookie of the Year award, an MVP award, a Gold Glove award, and a World Series championship. Really, you had to watch him play to really appreciate how great he was. Gritty, tough guy. I could still see those fist fights at home plate when you were allowed to crash into a catcher. With Carlton Fisk. It was just a special era of baseball, and he was the poster child for what tough baseball players were all about back then. All right, Dante, what do we got this week? What's happening?
So it's that time of year where baseball is kind of winding down, but football is ramping up. So we're going to talk a little baseball first. A little history has been made in baseball, some good, some bad. We'll start with the good. Shohei Ohtani had the game of his life, makes MLB history by becoming the first player with 50 stolen bases and 50 home runs in a single season. What are your thoughts on it?
So I'm going to sound like a hater here today, all right? And I don't want to be because I like Ohtani. And if he's the face of baseball, it could be worse, right? You know, it could be Barry Bonds, a guy who's cheating, right? Or the second baseman from the Astros, help me.
Altuve,
a guy who cheated only lower, you know this, but no, it's if you know I like to think it's Judge because I'm a Yankee fan, but if it's Ohtani, I have no problem with him being the face of baseball. Guy's an amazing athlete in so many ways. I mean, he's a terrific pitcher, but also a great hitter. But I'm getting sick of the inflating Ohtani story. Now, they said it was the single great. Now he broke a record that night. No, he set a record that night, right? The first 50 home run, 50 stolen base season of all time. And people are immediately saying, this is the greatest season of all time. All right. Because he had 50 home runs and 50 stolen bases. Well, when 40-40 had never been done before, was that the greatest season of all time? No. Okay, but this is suddenly the greatest season of all time. That game, he goes 6-for-6, 3 home runs, 2 doubles, 2 stolen bases, and 10 RBIs. It's a pretty amazing game, right? They're saying the greatest game of all time. Everything is the greatest of all time now, right? That it happened now. All right, so a couple of games to compare it to, all right? And I'm just going to pick one. Sean Green in 2002 also went 6-for-6, but he hit 4 home runs. Okay, and had 18 total bases, 7 RBIs, not 10, okay? But 4 home runs, okay, and 19 total bases. Oh, and by the way, when he hit his last home runs and his last at-bats, the game wasn't 700-0, and a position player pitching to him like happened to Ohtani, all right? That's nonsense. You know, you said that you think position players pitching is bad for the game, and you suggested that there should be a run rule like we have in Little League, that if you're winning by this many runs after a certain amount of innings, game's over. No different than a rainout. All right. And everybody go home because we don't want to embarrass the game by making this left fielder come in and throw meatballs up that get hit over the fence. Interesting take on your part. Okay. I happen to be coming around to that. I wasn't all in on it when I first heard it from you, but I'm starting to believe in it. Okay. But now, should we start racking up records? And by the way, the manager keeps him in there to rack up the records. He had Betts out to rest. He had Freeman out to rest. But he keeps Ohtani in to hit a home run off a left fielder. I mean, so that's a little BS, okay? And don't tell me, but he's also a pitcher. He's not a pitcher right now, okay? And you want to say the greatest game of all time? In 1971, Rick Wise pitched a no-hitter and hit two home runs in that game. Is that the greatest game of all time? Pitcher-hitter, okay? Two home runs, and he pitched a no-hitter in one game. Let's see you do that, Ohtani. All right? So is that the greatest game of all time? So I'm tired of the greatest game of all time. But even worse than that, they're saying that he's having the greatest season of all time. All right? Now, he's not even having the greatest season of this time. Okay? Because Judge is having a better season. Okay? Judge has more home runs, more RBIs, and about 20 points higher in batting average than him. All right? And while Ohtani is sitting in the dugout, waxing his bat, Judge is playing MVP caliber center field. All right? So it's not even the best season of this year. Okay? It's not even the best season of last year. Because Ronald Acuna, who was last year's MVP, okay, stole 25 more bases than him and had 30 points higher in batting average. All right, had less home runs, but not by that many, about 10 less home runs. All right, so you could compare that already. So don't tell me this is the greatest of this and this is the greatest of that. And this business of he's the greatest player of all time, when he comes back, let's see how he's pitching and let's start the discussion again. In the meantime, he's only pitched like 2.5 full seasons when you add it all together. This is not the greatest of all time just yet. So I'm a little sick of the Ohtani thing. I don't know how you feel, but that's where my head is.
I mean, I agree with you. It's not the greatest season of all time. It's not, like you said, it's not the greatest season of this year. It's the second best season of this year behind Judge. But that's not where I'm going to go with this. I'm going to go with, yes, he just was the first person to do it, 50-50 season. He's not going to be the last. I really think it's going to be done. I'm hesitant to say a lot more, but it will be done in the near future. With the bases being bigger, everybody's stealing bases now. So is that going to be the only 50-50 season of all time? No. Give it 3 years. Acuna will have a 50-50 season if he stays healthy. Plenty of them will happen. Just wait. Bases are bigger. This isn't going to be a one-and-done type record. So that's my quick take on this.
Yeah. And athletes, you know, are bigger, getting bigger, stronger, faster. Yeah. Right. So to your point, you're going to see more of this. I believe that it's not like, you know, Mickey Mantle was an outlier in his day. They said he was and so was Willie Mays. You know, Mickey Mantle was the fastest player in baseball when he first came up. Willie Mays was super fast as well. And they were both powerful men. They were outliers because the typical powerful guys back then were not fast. They were just big and muscular and they lumbered around the bases. And then there was the fast guys that you put up in the front of the lineup. Those days are over. Athletes are different now. They're more well-rounded. So I think you're right. You're going to see more guys that are both powerful and fast. And, you know, you said the bases are bigger. When we interviewed Mickey Rivers, he said he'd steal 100 bases nowadays.
Yeah.
With the limited number of throws to first base that you're allowed, you know, the time clock, wider, bigger bases, all reasons to be easier to steal these days. So you're right. Chicago White Sox tied a record of the 1962 Mets for a futility record. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I wish they didn't so the Mets could still hold that, but it's the White Sox. We knew this was going to happen. They were on pace for this last month and the month before and the month before that. Their team is terrible. The White Sox are the worst team of all time, and now the stats will show that. It's something we saw coming, so I'm not going to say this is the biggest thing in the world, but yeah, I mean, the White Sox are terrible. I mean, I got friends that are White Sox fans. Got a feel for them.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's really, really bad stuff.
You know, it's horrible when you think about it. You know, like, oh, the worst record of all time, the worst record of all time. But until you look at the actual record, does it really hit you? The Mets that year, 1962, were 40-120. And the White Sox right now are 37-120. They've won 37 games and they lost 120. It's mind-boggling. And, you know, in defense of the Mets, they were an expansion team.
Yeah.
And back then, the expansion teams, it was slim pickings that they got. Nowadays, in some sports like hockey, you know, there's a lot of good players to pick from. Look, the Vegas Golden Knights, yep, you know, went straight to a championship games, you know, in the Stanley Cup Finals with an expansion team, because you get to pick some good players. Back then, it was slim pickings for an expansion team. And the Mets, you got to give them a pass on this. I mean, there was a reason for them to have only won 40 games in the entire season. Oh my God, painful. There was no excuse for the Chicago White Sox, a team that's been here for 100 years, and you can't sink that low. You could have off years. You could have rebuilding years. We've all seen teams do this where they slip to only win 70 games. They have a sub-500 record. You know, 37-120? How could that be? And speaking of pathetic, the Oakland A's are closing up shop.
Yeah, it's the last series for the A's in Oakland. We've been to the stadium. It's a dump. Horrible. They need to get out of there, and thankfully they are. But actually, right before this podcast, I saw a video on Instagram of a fan who was able to rip the seats out of the ground. Now, yeah, that stadium is ancient. It was more of a football field than it was a baseball park. But just a funny thing that I've been just thinking of the last 10 minutes was Thursday's game, their last game in Oakland, is actually a sellout. They have two less seats now. The A's are notorious for doing nothing for their fans. Are they going to give them two more seats? Are they going to have to bring lawn chairs? What's going to happen? I mean, just that is the most Oakland A's thing that I can think of.
Oh, God. Yeah, well, you know what? The Oakland A's management just topped things off. They told the Oakland A's team, the manager and the players, when the game ends, don't stay on the field. Don't say goodbye to the fans. Just leave. Pack up and leave. Who says this? Think about it. When the Yankees left the original Yankee Stadium, they had a whole ceremony on the field, and Jeter was the captain, and he had a microphone, and he thanked the fans, and we'll see you across the street and next year with the new stadium. And the people, just leave. You know, just go away and leave, all right? But you want to know something? The Oakland fans deserve it because they've never supported that team, all right? That team has had some really great seasons, some great championships, some competitive teams, some superstar, exciting Hall of Fame players, and they've never supported those teams. And that town just keeps losing teams. They lost the Oakland Raiders. They lost the Warriors in basketball. Yep. And now they're going to lose the A's. And I think if your team is the Athletics or the A's, you're kind of cursed because they went from Philadelphia to Kansas City to Oakland. Now with Sacramento for a little while before they try to get into Vegas. They should just never unpack their bags. That's just, it goes on and on, but
yeah,
sad times. Sad to see the Oakland A's no longer be the Oakland A's. I grew up with the Oakland A's being in the '70s, a powerhouse. You know, with the years of Catfish Hunter and Reggie Jackson, and we talk about them as being Yankees, but they were A's, you know, and Sal Bando and Joe Rudy, and the crazy Charlie Finley, their owner, and paying the guys to grow mustaches so they had a look. It was giving them nicknames when they didn't even have a nickname because it was going to be something to sell. You know, the story is Catfish Hunter, Jim Catfish Hunter, didn't have a nickname. Finley calls him to his office and says, "Do you have a nickname?" He says, "No, sir." He says, "Well, okay, we're going to give you one now. You're going to be Catfish from out of the blue, Catfish." He says, "Why?" He says, "Well, here's the story. You're gonna say that you left the house one day as a child and your parents couldn't find you, and you went fishing the whole day, and they were all nervous that you were missing, and then you came home at the end of the day, and you had caught a catfish. That's going to be your name. So this is the owner, how he was thinking promotionally all the time. And the whole even the colors of the uniforms. Nobody had bright colored uniforms back then. Everybody was white and gray, a little splash of blue, you know, and then these multiple uniforms for different occasions. And sometimes they wore the greens and sometimes the golds. You know, he tried to introduce an orange baseball. Didn't fly, but this is where his head was. There was something special about the Oakland A's of that era. I hate to see these teams. I hated when the Raiders left. I hated when the Colts left Baltimore. Certain things that I grew up with, I hate seeing going away. But things change. Things change. But mentioning the Colts brings us, I guess, to football. Because we're
not yet.
Okay, go ahead.
The Detroit Tigers, out of nowhere, are now in a playoff spot by a game, knocked out the Twins again as of right now. About 5 games to go for both teams. Nobody saw this coming. This is the biggest surprise, I would say in the last 3 years. There hasn't been a team that has came out of nowhere with no real superstar and then just turn a season around and get in a playoff spot. I mean, Derek Scoobal might win Cy Young.
Will win.
But yes. But, I mean, without him, not looking at Scoobal, what do they have? It's a very interesting team that just caught fire at the right time. It'll be interesting to see if they can keep that playoff spot and what they can do in the wild card.
The two things that I come away with, number one, this team is going to be good for a while.
Yeah.
A lot of good young players. Okay, so whether they hang on to that position, if they make any noise in the playoffs, if they get in or not, remains to be seen. But they're going to be good for a while. And the second thing is they traded their second best starter at the trade deadline to the Dodgers, right? Because they were going to give up on the year. And they brought up a bunch of kids, and look what happened. You know, did they pull the plug a little too soon, maybe? Or maybe the kids that they replaced them with are the reason that they've caught fire. Interesting, you know. Since you said we're not allowed to finish on baseball yet, I'm going to say one last thing. Crazy storms and hurricanes and the end of the universe are happening down south. And the Mets, who came from out of nowhere with the best record in the second half to from 10 games under 500 to suddenly they're in a playoff position, fighting with the Braves for that position, are playing against them again today, lost to the Braves yesterday. And the Mets have to be praying for rain right now, because if the game is played, Chris Sale's pitching against them tonight. Chris Sale will win the Cy Young Award in the National League this year. And if he beats them tonight, they'll be all even, okay? Because they will have come back 2 games in a row. If this game gets rained out, they all go their separate ways, and they would have to come back for a doubleheader, and who knows who could start then, a big advantage for the Mets. So the Mets right now have to be praying for rain down in Atlanta. But be interesting to see.
I think it did get postponed.
There you go. So they're supposed to play again tomorrow, but it's supposed to be worse weather tomorrow.
Mm-hmm. I think so the doubleheader is going to be after the next series.
After the next series. Got to go to Milwaukee, I believe, and then come back to Atlanta, where Sale will have already pitched. And they will not be facing him the next time around. So this actually, and even if they were miraculously able to play the doubleheader tomorrow, again, an advantage to the Mets, because the Mets just need to win one of those 2 games to stay ahead. And it's hard to sweep a doubleheader. So that puts, you know, 1 game at a time, the Braves may have been able to do it. Winning a doubleheader would be tough. So, all right. So we're blending from baseball into football. Actually, I'm blending baseball into football because I'm wearing my Aaron Judge baseball football jersey. All right. So this is my blend. All right. See how I'm on this? What do you think?
Yeah.
I'm good, right? I'm good. I'm all over this. Football, weird week last week. I don't know what's going on in football. The best teams look like garbage. The best players are not doing well. But let's pick a game this coming week that you can't miss. What's your game? If you have to watch one game and you can't miss anything, what's it going to be?
I'm going to go with Packers-Vikings. Divisional matchup. Sam Darnold, I mean, I've been saying it. Right now, he'd probably be the front runner for MVP. Yes, it's been 3 weeks.
Or comeback player of the year, or both.
Yes, or comeback player of the year. I think Rodgers probably has that no matter what, but Darnold is leading that team. They're 3-0 right now, and they're facing the Packers. Jordan Love, still questionable. But even if Jordan Love doesn't play, Malik Willis looks good. I mean, everybody said the Titans' defense was good. It's looked a little shaky, but for Malik Willis to do what he did on Sunday against that defense, I mean, he's running all over them too. The Packers are not a team that just rolled over and played dead when their quarterback got hurt. So for me, this is the game of the week.
Malik Willis did really well last week and the week before even. I think it's Matt LaFleur is a genius. You know, yep. you see how important coaching is in professional football. You got the right coach. He doesn't say, you have to fit my system. He says, let me make a system that fits you. And he changed everything around to make it work with Willis, and it's going great guns over there. He's terrific. Terrific coach. Okay, so my game, Bills-Ravens. Okay, Bills are 3-0, look like the real deal. Ravens, 1-2, almost gave up a game to the floundering Cowboys after a big lead. So Lamar Jackson sooner or later needs to show that he could win the big-time games, the big matchups, all right? He's a two-time MVP now. He's all the talent in the world, right? But when push comes to shove, he doesn't get the job done. And this is going on for too long now. He's going to have to start winning games like this. You don't want to fall to 1-3, you know, after only four games. You don't want to fall to another top competitor, because if the two competitors coming into the year were the Chiefs and the Bills, and you've lost to both of them in the first four games, this sets a bad tone for what your season is. Lamar Jackson has to step it up, and it's a big game for the Ravens for that reason. The Bills, on the other hand, you talked about best player in football was your number 15, mm-hmm. Patrick Mahomes. So I'm going to say right now, Josh Allen is not only the best player on the Bills, he's not only the best quarterback in the league, he's the best player in the league. Right now, Josh Allen is the best player in the NFL, okay? I'm not taking anything away from Mahomes. Guy's amazing, okay? He's an amazing player. He's a winner, okay? And until Allen proves that he's that kind of winner, right, the crown stays with Mahomes. I get that, all right? I have all the respect for that guy in the world, okay? But right now, the way teams are playing, the way players are playing, Josh Allen is the best player in the league. If the season ended now, he would get the MVP. He is the best player in the league, and he's doing it all. And boy, I love that he's doing it without Diggs, because all that talk and that showing up as quarterback and yelling on the sidelines and all the things you don't do in sports, okay, Allen is just eaten up that he's got guys that are happy if they get two throws a game and one look a game and they win. And that's why they're steamrolling everybody. So big game for the Ravens more than the Bills. If the Bills were to lose this game, they lose to a good team and they're 3-1. The Ravens lose this game, they lost to another one of their head-to-head competitors and they're 1-3. Big game there. Big game there.
The Bills are really surprising everybody. I mean, they just killed the Jags. I mean,
yeah.
Real quick, I want to talk about Trevor Lawrence. He was the generational prospect. If we look at his NFL career, it's below average. Just the NFL career, he's a below average quarterback. And this is, I talked about Bryce Young being the biggest bust because of who came after him. But hype-wise, I mean, we got to start talking about this. Trevor Lawrence, he's turning into a bust. He is.
I don't know that I'd say bust, but I might say not living up to what was expected.
expect it was Peyton Manning.
Yeah, so I don't think he's living up to Peyton Manning. He's not. I don't think he's a bust. He's still a very serviceable young quarterback. He's had three full seasons. One of them was excellent. One of them was under Urban Meyer. Holding his head on the sidelines.
Will Levis has taken Will Levis that ground.
Has got, yes, yes. His role model. Let's hold my head. Okay. The jury is out on Trevor Lawrence, but it's not like he's not worthy of an NFL starting position. He may not be worthy of that big contract they gave him. That remains to be seen. Yeah. But he's not a bust. Not a bust. But we shall see. We shall see. Quarterbacks get big money, so we'll see. All right, Dante, I think that's it, huh? Mm-hmm. All right, so this is that part of the show that we call yesterday, today, before, and after. Dante talks about something that's going on now that's on his mind. I talk about something that's happened in years gone by that's on mine. Dante, take it away.
Yes, we mentioned it before. The NFL this past week, a little underwhelming. Bunch of blowouts, bunch of big-time matchups that just didn't really pan out. And life as a Yankee fan, even though we have the second-best record in baseball, it just there's not that juice like there used to be. So I've been watching some UFC. A couple weekends ago was a big fight with Sean O'Malley, and this was a pay-per-view fight for UFC. Everybody's watching, and O'Malley comes out and just lays an egg. It was not a competitive fight. Wasn't an entertaining fight, but that got me thinking. These UFC fights, people want to maintain their attractive records. If you're 17-1, you want to go 18-1. But a win by decision is just good enough for them. I don't really like that because the fights, they're not bloodbaths anymore. They're just, I won by decision. Let's move on. Look at my record. No. So I've been watching the Dana White Contender Series. And that is MMA fighters looking to get contracts into the UFC. So the way it works, there's five fights every Tuesday night. If you win at the end of the episode, Dana White can give you a contract. And it's really cool stuff. So I want to talk about two fights. One of them last week, one of them yesterday. Last week, Ahmad Hasanzada beat Dylan Mantello. And I don't want to talk about the fight. I want to talk about his story. It's from Afghanistan. The way they described the story was that they're dropping bombs on him, shooting at him in Afghanistan. The Taliban is shooting at him, trying to take him in. But the Americans swoop in and take him out and save him. Then he starts a life in America, becomes an MMA fighter. And guess what? He got a contract last week. So now he's officially a UFC fighter. Really cool stuff. Really cool story. Check that out if you want to. And the next one I want to talk about happened last night. Danilo Vojvodkin. Definitely mispronounced that, but he's going against a -800 favorite who played football at the University of Minnesota. So Vojvodkin's from Ukraine. They describe his competition that he's been fighting as absolute nothings. I mean, he beats up on a guy. One of the guys he beat has lost 23 fights in a row. So you want to talk about these great UFC records, and you want to talk about these guys that he's fighting. Well, he's fighting against a -800 favorite. Last night, a heavyweight fight knocks him out in round one, and he wins. And Dana White loves underdog stories, so what does he do? He gives him a UFC contract. He's the first Ukrainian to be employed by the UFC. So really cool stuff. If you guys are into MMA or even boxing, because the Contender Series fights are less grappling heavy and more boxing heavy. So if you want to check that out, I recommend it every Tuesday night, 8 o'clock Eastern on ESPN+.
We got an interview coming up too.
We do. Joey Hart. Joey the Hitman Hart. It's going to be fun.
Yeah. We'll air that soon. We're going to be interviewing him very, very soon.
Yes.
All right. So the White Sox futility had me thinking about the early years of the New York Mets. And I growing up in the Bronx, surrounded by baseball fans. Everyone was a Dodgers fan, a Yankees fan, a Giants fan. Then there were Yankee fans and Met fans, and it was the constant arguing and what fandom is all about. It was beautiful, actually. I know recently I spoke to Brandon Tierney from WFAN, and he said, "Well, how could you hate the Mets? Because I do. How could you hate the Mets? You've had all these championships and the Mets so few." And I said, "You know, you don't understand. When I was growing up, it was a little different. Lean years for the Yankees through the 60s and into the 70s. And the Mets at 1969, 1973 world champ, you know, into the World Series and such. So it was different. But the White Sox being this bad made me think about the early years of the Mets and reminded me that the Mets were so bad back then that on the back of milk containers were coupons. And if you'd cut out these coupons, okay, I could just imagine kids today doing it. Now you'd scan a QR code and you'd turn green and it automatically walk through the gates of a ballpark. But then you cut out these coupons, and if you saved 20 of these coupons, you get a free ticket to a game. And there was a list on the back of the milk container which games were available. So here, as much as I was a Yankee fan, not a Met fan, we were baseball fans. We want to go to games free, right? So I'm cutting out these coupons diligently. And I liked the Cubs. Yankees, my team, but I liked the Cubs because I liked Ernie Banks. I liked Billy Williams and those players, you know, for the National League. They weren't opposing the Yankees, so I could like them. And the Cubs were in first place, and there were games on there to go see the Mets play the Cubs. So we cut out all these coupons and we mailed them in. Literally in a rubber band, in an envelope, put a stamp, you mail it in, and back come these tickets. And my brother and I and my father are going to go to these Met games against the Cubs. Well, as luck would have it, the Mets catch fire and they make a run chasing down the Cubs. No one sees the Mets coming. This is the worst team in history, remember, right? Just a couple of years earlier. They make a run and they're chasing down the Cubs for the championship. And 55 years ago this week, the Cubs are clinging to a small but shrinking lead to the Mets. And the two teams face each other in Shea Stadium, that rickety old dump, which wasn't that old back then because it was rebuilt. It was built new because of the World's Fair was there, but it was a dump even though it was new. And the two teams are going to face each other in Shea. And the opposing pitchers were Ferguson Jenkins for the Cubs and Tom Seaver for the Mets. We're talking about two of the greatest pitchers of all time. Tom Seaver, the greatest pitcher in my lifetime. In the top of the fourth inning, something really crazy happens. Now, remember, the Cubs had not won a World Series in 100 years. And here they are, first place. But the Mets are sneaking up on them. In the fourth inning, a black cat appears and walks into their dugout. The stadium went nuts. Okay, because this is the ultimate bad luck, the curse, right? Mets won the game. Mets won the pennant. Mets won the World Series. But I can't think about the stinky Mets of the early 60s without thinking about the miracle Mets of 1969 and that game that we went to, which was one of the most exciting games here. Even though I was rooting for the Cubs, it was super exciting. Dante, that's it. Wrap it up.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, you know where to find us. Full episodes on Spotify and YouTube, short clips on TikTok and Instagram. And if you haven't, join the chat page. We'd love to hear from you over there. So thank you for tuning in to Season 2, Episode 15 of 10th Inning Screwballs from Dante Esposito.
And Sevy Esposito.
Have a good week.
Go get your shine box. Ciao.